Hi everyone, Omores here. Today it's about running Windows XP on a high-end setup featuring a i5-14600KF and a Z790 motherboard from ASUS. With this setup, I was expecting some resistance while dealing with older operating systems like XP, but no, actually installing Windows XP is much easier than you might think if you just forget about using a USB stick and you'll do it from DOS using a custom ISO loaded with the right drivers. Alright, before we get into the installation, let's take a closer look at our configuration. So we have an Intel i5-14600KF paired with the ASUS Prime Z790-P Wi-Fi motherboard, which features a retro-friendly PS2 port. Now about cooling, the Ikaza cooler originally ordered show up a week late. So in the meantime, I had to improvise with an ID cooling SC240XT. This is a budget cooler retailing for around $30. But I got it for just $10 as an open box return. The catch? Well, the original fan didn't make it back into the box. No big deal, right? How hard can it be to mount some standard fan? As you saw, some tools were required to modify the fan, but in the end, everything worked out smoothly. We also have 32 gigabytes of ADATA Lancer DDR5 5600 dual channel RAM. While it might not seem like a big deal, these modules need to be installed in the gray slots, labeled A2 and B2 to properly load the XMP profiles and get the most out of them. Like any other Z790 motherboard, this one features a 16x PCI Express slot. Anyway, for Windows XP, we'll start with an NVIDIA 7900GS, which is a first generation PCI Express card from 2006. After all, PCI Express 5.0 is designed to be full backward compatible, and indeed it is. As you are about to see, our PC posted at the very first boot, even if the motherboard is configured to boot in UEFI mode. Using a non-UEFI video card isn't an issue. The compatibility support module, CSM, is automatically enabled, ensuring everything works seamlessly. And now, with our configuration up and running, let's dive straight into Windows XP setup. First, we need Windows XP, the Integral Edition, preferably the last version. If we are in a hurry and we're gonna use the included Windows XP ISO, won't work on this configuration simply because it has no updated drivers. To solve this, we have to use the included tool called Patch Integrator. This tool allows us to create a custom Windows XP ISO by integrating the specific drivers we need from a list. For example, if our motherboard is from 2016 or later, we'll need a patch ACPI driver, not to mention drivers for AHCI, NVME, or USB 3. Once our custom ISO is ready, we extract its contents onto a DOS bootable partition and start the installation from there using the WinNT executable located in the i386 folder. For this setup, I extracted the contents into a folder named CDXP2024, which was copied onto a DOS bootable SATA drive. I'll skip the details of creating a DOS bootable partition. This process has been covered many times in my previous videos. If you need a refresher, check out my earlier tutorials on installing Windows XP, Windows 95, 98, or Millennium. It's exactly 100% the very same process. At this stage, once we have booted from our installation drive, we need to navigate into the i386 folder and type WinNT to initiate the DOS portion of the Windows XP installation. This step creates temporary installation folders and, most importantly, puts NTLDR in charge as a boot manager. This also means that if the installation drive isn't properly recognized by Windows XP setup, we'll encounter the dreaded 07B blue screen. Just let me demonstrate by booting from the original XP Service Pack 2 CD. In this situation, since the SATA installation drive uses the AHCI protocol, not known by XP Service Pack 2, our drive isn't recognized and the installation ends here. Now let's switch back to our current installation that is using a custom ISO loaded with updated drivers. Well, not only is the SATA driver recognized this time, but also the NVMe drive, which is pretty cool if you ask me. From now on, the installation is the same business as usual, with one notable exception. During the process, we might encounter errors about missing files, specifically about setup.org.exe and presetup.cmd. At first glance, it might seem like an issue with our custom ISO, but it's actually a known issue of Windows XP installations, with discussions about this error dating back to 2007 in a quick Google search. No problem, we can fix this. When prompted about the missing files, we can simply press Escape to skip them. After the next restart, however, we'll need to manually copy these files into Windows/System32 folder. So where do we find them? They're actually in the i386 installation folder, but for some reason the setup program doesn't pick them automatically. To fix this, I booted from a DOS bootable USB stick, navigated to the i386 folder, and copied the missing files into the newly created Windows/System32 directory. Next, the integral edition part of the installation will kick in. We will be prompted to install some updates and several third-party programs. While this is generally not the best idea, manually installing them later can be time-consuming. It's usually best to stick with the default settings, perhaps deselecting a few unnecessary programs from the list. The good news is that after the next restart, we'll have a fully operational and up-to-date Windows XP Service Pack 3, specifically the x86 32-bit version. In the meantime, I swapped out the 7900GS GPU for a GTX 980, which is almost officially supported in Windows XP. Technically, the last GPU with official XP support is the GTX 960. However, with a slightly modified driver, any card from GTX 980 series works flawlessly on XP. As you know, this 14th-gen CPU features both E-cores and P-cores, which might seem problematic for older operating systems. However, in practice, everything runs smoothly. I didn't encounter a single blue screen, even under some stress testing. Next, a very nice thing to have is USB 3X support, of course. And guess what? On this motherboard, it simply works if we don't forget to include drivers on our custom installation disk. For testing, I used an external USB 3.2 SSD from Kingston, and the transfer speeds were very close to the drive's official specifications. This performance is significantly better than my previous tests, with a 13th-gen Intel configuration on an ASUS H610 motherboard, where the same drive only managed about 350 megabytes per second. How about NVMe performance? Well, it's excellent. I tested a Western Digital Gen 3 NVMe drive, and the results matched the specification from the product brief. No surprises in this department. So far, so good. What about audio? The easiest option for sound is through HDMI. Anyway, this motherboard features a Realtek ALC897 8097 codec, which is more or less the same thing as a slightly older LC8092 codec. In any case, I managed to get it working using the last available high-definition audio drivers for Windows XP. It was a nice surprise. Now, can we ask for more? How about 2.5 gigabit networking? Well, this motherboard uses a Realtek 8125 chip, which has official drivers for Windows 7. While there might be a backported driver for XP, I couldn't find one during a quick search. Instead, I went with a standard PCIe 1X gigabit card, also from Realtek. Let's not forget that we can use various USB Wi-Fi sticks. Most of them will work with XP. So getting online, it's easy and shouldn't be a concern. Don't believe in fairy tales, especially if you are behind a router. Most routers run a form of Linux, which will block malicious traffic targeting older Windows XP exploits. For browsing, we can use the included MyPal or Supermium, which is a Chrome-based browser that is relatively up-to-date. And speaking of updates, while editing this video, a new version of Windows XP Integral Edition was released just yesterday. Be sure to check it out. That's it for today. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned. Many more videos like this are about to come.